So this is actually going to work really well with the sermon today. We did this thing that happens when you're an organization, and we got our wires crossed. And at 8:45 this morning, realized that the scripture that most of the staff had and the scripture I was using weren't the same scripture. And that includes, by the way, your bulletin. So just disregard the scripture in there. It's not important. Pretend like you never saw it. And this will go well with the sermon, actually, because this week, everybody here knows that I'm a baseball fan, and I'm not able to go more than a few months without mentioning some baseball story. And this week, the baseball story of all baseball stories broke, which is that Willie Mays died at 93. And Willie Mays is not just a baseball player. Willie Mays is arguably the greatest baseball player of all time. And if not the greatest, one of the two or three greatest. And he is considered that because he was good at everything. He ran faster than everybody else. He could throw the ball better than everybody else. He had a good batting average. He hit 660 home runs. There are three players with more home runs than that in baseball history. And I want to bring him up because I want to start by saying this. His life and career, terrible metaphor for faith. Terrible metaphor. And here's why. Who can be good at everything? And this is where this feeds into our scripture for this week. Because our scripture for this week reminds us, encourages us not to look at the greatest, but rather at underdogs. And so I would say this about Willie Mays' life. If you can live a life of faith like Willie Mays played baseball, do it. But I'm going to guess you can't. But there are, I think, other examples of folks who aren't good at everything, accomplishing great stuff. And my favorite, and this is how I want to start the sermon, is actually the 1980 U.S. hockey team. The 1980 U.S. hockey team, if you don't know the story, beat the Soviet Union in the semifinals of the Olympics 4-3. And it is one of my favorite sporting events ever, which includes the best radio broadcaster call of all time, "Do You Believe in Miracles?" And I can remember growing up as a kid learning about this, and my mom lived in Milwaukee back in the late 70s, and she actually went and saw the team just before they went to the Olympics, the U.S. team, and she told me they were terrible. Like, lost to a junior college team, terrible. And the Soviets, meanwhile, won, like, the 6 medals before this Olympics and the 6 medals after. They just could not be beat. And yet, the U.S. won this game. And this is the story. The U.S. did not have the best players. They didn't even bring the best players available to them. They didn't have as good of a record. And so how did the U.S. win this game? Well, some of it was luck. Just to be frank, a lot of sports is luck. The goalie of the U.S. team had the best game of his career by far. The best game of his career. But what I think is so helpful about thinking about this team is that they did something that we need to learn about in our own faith walk, which is they played to their strengths. One of the reasons the U.S. team didn't bring their best players is that they decided to bring a young team. So the average age of the U.S. players on that Olympic team was just a hair over 21 years old. Can you imagine being a 20-year-old playing on the biggest stage? And the Soviet team, meanwhile, their average age was over 25 years old, and they had players who were 35 playing big minutes. And so that doesn't sound like a lot, but when you're looking for advantages, you take what you can get. And the U.S. coach, by all reports, must have known this, because folks around the team saw that conditioning was a huge factor in their work together. And this is the key. What can you do when you're younger that gets harder as you get older? I just heard an everything from the audience. That is fair. But you can work harder without getting tired. I think anybody who has aged even a little bit knows this. When you're a kid and you're like, oh, I'm gonna get in shape for the upcoming football season, it's like 3 weeks of daily running and you're there. When you're an adult, it's like, okay, I've got 6 months and I'm gonna be sore all the time and it's gonna hurt. And even when I get there, it's not gonna be all that great. So you feel like you're slower, you feel like you're more sluggish. And then when you're done, you have to rest. And so the difference of the US team at 21 and the Russian team at 25 doesn't seem like a big deal, but it is something. And in that final game, what commentators will comment on is that the US defenders were able to skate the entire game. They just didn't get tired. They were able to keep going and keep working and keep moving. And it's because, well, it's because they leaned into what they were good at. They got conditioned. They worked hard. They skated hard. And this is the lesson for us today. The U.S. did not have the experience advantage. They didn't have the skill advantage. They didn't have the strength advantage. They probably weren't even as smart as the Soviet hockey team, who had come up with a culture obsessed with winning from a very young age. And so rather than try to compete with the Soviets in all of those areas of hockey, they instead just leaned into what they are good at. And this lesson comes up in our scripture for today. Rather than try to match someone else, lean into your own skills and talents. Rather than try to be like the person you see doing everything right, instead, discern with the help of the Spirit what it is you are good at and do that. So let's listen to our reading today, which is from 1 Samuel chapter 17, verses 4 through 11 and 32 through 49. And there came out from the camp of the Philistines a champion named Goliath of Gath, whose height was 4 cubits and a span. He had a helmet of bronze on his head, and he was armed with a coat of mail. The weight of the coat was 5,000 shekels of bronze. He had greaves of bronze in his legs and a javelin of bronze slung between his shoulders. The shaft of his spear was like a weaver's beam, and his spear's head weighed 600 shekels of iron, and his shield bearer went before him. He stood and shouted to the ranks of Israel, "Why have you come out to draw up for battle? Am I not a Philistine? And are you not servants of Saul? Choose a man for yourself and let him come down to me. If he is able to fight with me and kill me, then we will be your servants. But if I prevail against him and kill him, then you shall be our servants and serve us." And the Philistine said, "Today I defy the ranks of Israel. Give me a man that we may fight together." When Saul and all of Israel heard these words of the Philistine, they were dismayed and greatly afraid. But David said to Saul, "Let no one's heart fail because of him. Your servant will go and fight with this Philistine." Saul said to David, "You are not able to go against this Philistine to fight with him, for you were just a boy, and he has been a warrior from his youth." But David said to Saul, "Your servant used to keep sheep for his father, and whenever a lion or a bear came and took a lamb from the flock, I went after it and struck it down, rescuing the lamb from its mouth. And if it turned against me, I would catch it by the jaw, strike it down, and kill it. So your servant has killed both lions and bears, and this uncircumcised Philistine shall be like one of them, since he has defied the armies of the living God." David said, "The Lord who saved me from the paw of the lion and from the paw of the bear will save me from the hand of the Philistine." So Saul said to David, "Go and may the Lord be with you." So Saul clothed David with armor He put a bronze helmet on his head and clothed him with a coat of mail. And David strapped Saul's sword over the armor, and he tried in vain to walk, for he was not used to them. Then David said to Saul, "I cannot walk with these, for I am not used to them." So David removed them. Then he took a staff in his hand and chose 5 smooth stones from the wadi and put them in his shepherd's bag, in the pouch. His sling was in his hand, and he drew near to the Philistine. The Philistine came on and drew near to David with his shield bearer in front of him. And when the Philistine looked and saw David, he disdained him, for he was only a youth, ruddy and handsome in appearance. The Philistine said to David, "Am I a dog that you come to me with sticks?" And the Philistine cursed David by his gods. The Philistine said to David, "Come to me, and I will give you flesh, give your flesh to the birds of the air and to the wild animals of the field." But David said to the Philistine, "You come to me with sword and spear and javelin, but I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied. This very day the Lord will deliver you into my hand, and I will strike you down and cut off your head, and I will give the dead bodies of the Philistine army this very day to the birds of the air and to the wild animals of the earth, so that all may know that there is a God in Israel, and that all this assembly may know that the Lord does not save by sword and spear, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give you into our land." When the Philistine drew near to meet David, David ran quickly toward the battle line to meet the Philistine. David put his hand in his bag, took out a stone, slung it, and struck the Philistine in his forehead. The stone sank into his forehead, and he fell down on his face on the ground. Oh my God, bless this reading. Anybody else feel like we've been to the movies? You know, last week we listened to the scripture in which Israel goes to Samuel and says, "We need you to appoint us a king." And they sent Samuel, the judge and the prophet, to ask God for guidance. And the reason they give is that they want to be like the other nations. And God asks them the question, "Why have you abandoned me? Why have you decided that rather than be a people set apart, you have instead become a people like the other nations?" So God has this warning for them. You are going to have a king, and bad things are going to happen, including war. And what a surprise. God is right. We learn in following scriptures that Saul is beginning to have a hard time. Saul is trying his best, but as they build up and become like the other nations, they are now facing off on the brink of war with the Philistines. These people have come to challenge Israel, and representing them is this great, powerful, and humongous warrior, Goliath. Modern scholars estimate that he was probably close to 7 feet tall. So imagine Zach Eady, but with armor and all the rest. And so Israel is going to deal with this problem over and over and over again. They think that the only way to be in the world is to mimic those around them. And so when they go looking for a warrior, they can't find anybody who looks like Goliath. And frankly, nobody in Israel's ranks wants to pretend that they are a match for this giant. But then David volunteers. David, the shepherd boy, who is handsome and ruddy. And I love that the first thing they try to do with David is to make him like Goliath. So they strap all the armor to him. They give him the big weapons, the mail. And you can just imagine that that stuff weighs a lot, and that David is like one of those kids from A Christmas Story who can't move in his winter coat. And David says, "I can't do this. This isn't me." He takes it off and he chooses a different path. He's a shepherd boy. He's used to fending off big animals. He has this skill that you wouldn't expect him to have. And so he chooses 5 smooth stones. similar to the ones that he would have used to fend off predators in the fields with his sheep. And it's not what's expected. It's not using Goliath's methods. Rather, it's using David's strengths and experiences. David represents what God is trying to teach the people and what God is trying to teach us. Being like other nations, being like others, isn't actually a path forward. You have to do things differently. Be different, be set apart. And so David does so. And it's because he refuses to mimic others that he is successful. It's because he discerns what it is that God has gifted him with. Not long ago, the writer Malcolm Gladwell wrote a book about David and Goliath. And he said the lesson of the story is this. We consistently get these kinds of conflicts wrong. Giants are not what we think they are. The same qualities that appear to give them strength are often the sources of great weakness. So Goliath is big and strong, but he's also slow and burdened by his armor. David, on the other hand, is small and quick and experienced with a sling and stone from years of watching over herds of sheep. Goliath looks undefeatable and yet has weakness. David looks like a fly that you just flick off and get rid of, but in reality, he has hidden strength. You don't have to be good at everything to win. You know, when I was first starting out as a minister, there was a book that a lot of people really enjoyed around church leadership. It wasn't a book about church leadership, though. It was a business book that church leaders read. It's called Good to Great. And it basically tries to come up with how do businesses go from being okay to being great, to being businesses that you don't forget. And one of the answers in the book that is helpful for all of us to think about, including just the church in general, is that one of the things that keeps businesses from getting to the next level is trying to be good at everything. And instead, businesses that do exceptionally well in the world are actually those that simply focus on what they do best and just do that. My favorite example is not from the book. But it's from my trip to Ireland a couple years ago. And it has to do with Guinness. Maybe you've heard of Guinness. It's well known. But the story that we were told at the brew house is that way back in the day, and this is kind of the stuff of legend, that when Arthur Guinness started brewing beer in the late 1700s, Guinness made all kinds of beer. Ales and lagers and bitters and all different things. And one day, Arthur Guinness was thinking about the business and he made a decision. They weren't going to make all kinds of beers. And instead of trying to do everything well, instead of trying to do absolutely everything for everyone, they would instead focus on what they did best, which was, of course, their stout, which was brewed with a new form of malt that had been roasted until it was black as night. And of course, today, 250 years later, Guinness is not just known for that stout, they're synonymous with it. It's one of the most popular brands of any kind in the world. And they're kind of proving this point again. You don't have to do everything well. You don't have to be good at everything. You have to figure out what you are good at and do that. You have to figure out what you are good at, what your skills are, and develop those. And so that's the question for us. What are you good at? And not, what do you think you need to be good at? You know, if the U.S. hockey team in 1980 had asked, what do we need to be good at? They probably wouldn't have beat the Soviets. Needing to be good needing to be as good as Goliath is wearing armor gets you beat every time. But there is something to simplifying, to leaning into your strengths, to being good at one thing instead of all of the things. And that can be freeing. God did not make us to be like other people. God did not forget to give us Willie Mays-like skills. And faith requires a good amount of this. We all know that the exemplar and what it means to live faithfully is Jesus. You can look at Jesus' life and teachings and learn just about everything you need to know. And we should all try to be like him. And can you imagine what it would be like if we all held ourselves to that standard in everything we do? But God has gifted us each in our own way. God has given us the skills and the gifts to serve in our own way. And God calls us not to be spiritually gifted in every way, but in our own way. And if we're able to accept that, well, new possibilities open up. And I wonder what our gifts are here today. You know, if your gift is listening to folks, then offer it to your neighbor. Listen. If your gift is hospitality, then use it to connect with others. If it's being inquisitive, then ask the question that needs to be asked. Because if we're all going to measure ourselves by whether or not we're like Jesus in every way, then we're probably going to fall short. The U.S. hockey team measure themselves by their ability to be more skillful, strong, and experienced, they wouldn't have beaten the Soviets. And if we measure Guinness by how good they are at brewing IPAs, I mean, you're not going to remember them. And if David tried to defeat Goliath in big, heavy, burdensome armor, well, we wouldn't be telling the story today. Because faith is not about being exceptional in every aspect of life. It is about using the gifts that God has given us to serve. Let us pray. Well, Holy God, as we gather here today, we do so in your name, knowing that we are children of you, that you are the parent who has called us and nurtured us, that you have gifted us in so many ways. We pray, oh God, for this church, for all that you have given us, for the skills and the talents that you have granted it to us so that we might continue to seek to fulfill in all things your way in this world. Holy and gracious God, as we gather today, we pray these things in your name. Amen.